which is Wilfrid Laurier University student publications organization. And Nathaniel's also a third year journalism student. I'm going to turn it over to Nathaniel to explain how things will unfold.
Thank you very much. So today, the way that we're doing this is as an open forum. Each candidate will have a maximum of 3 minutes to begin with an introduction of themselves. After that, I will be asking questions, and each candidate will have a maximum of 2 minutes to reply, and then they will pass the mic on to the next candidate, who will then have 2 minutes to reply to the same question. Each candidate will then have a conclusion, which will last for 2 minutes, and they will potentially have time for questions from anyone in the audience afterwards. So the way that we're going to be doing this today also is we're going to be starting on the left and passing to the right. You're going to be passing to your left.
So I'm passing it that way.
Alright, so the first question that we have is, what is your definition of mayor, and what your background qualifies you for this position? And, oh, I'm so sorry. Please take 3 minutes to introduce yourself.
Thank you very much. I am Jan Vanderstel. I am running for mayor for the city of Frankfort. I am a standing councillor for Ward 1, which was one of the largest wards in the city before we changed that as a council. My wife and I are proud to be the parents of five children. Three girls are in college and university, and the youngest and the eldest are in Canadian Forces. I have spent a great deal of time in a number of post-secondary institutions, including McMaster University, Mohawk College, and Redeemer College University in Ancaster. A lot of the people in my family have gone through a number of different institutions. And there is one thing that is, for the most part, paramount when it comes to parents who think about where they want to send or place their kids and going to university or college anywhere, and that is safety. It always has to do with safety. Campus safety, travel safety, and housing safety. I am encouraged to hear how many people have taken the time, how many students have taken the time out in the last little while to have a chat with me in various different formats about exactly what in Brantford, the experience in Brantford, what it feels like, where are the good zones, where are the less good zones, where people feel comfortable, where they don't feel comfortable. And we have been comparing notes for quite some time now on what role the municipality could play to ensure that there is safety. Also, there is a question of interaction. If you come to Brantford for 4 years and you fall in love with Brantford, we want to make sure that we do what we can as a municipality to allow you the opportunity to stay in Brantford and find employment in Brantford, find a place to live, and keep falling in love with Brantford as the time goes on. Linda and I were very much aware of the fact that we see student housing growing and growing and growing in ever-increasing concentric circles around the core, and we know quite a few people who actually take the time out to make sure that students are listened to. Primarily, it's the students that we need to listen to. It's the students that I would be listening to, the student union, representatives thereof, any of the groups of people that normally form on a campus, like you would see with Sputnik, with sports affiliations, the Hawks. A lot of people want the opportunity to be heard, and they want their concerns to be listened to and dealt with, but they're not always necessarily sure on where to go. What I would do as a necessity is I would clear up those lines of communication so that if there's any issue that comes up at any time, I think everybody in the room has one of these. Yes? Put up your hand if you don't have one of these. These are important. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Rowe.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Moderator, Ms. Ferguson, students, guests, and fellow candidates. My name is Dave Rebell. I'm a candidate for the office of mayor. But who is Dave Rebell? Dave Rebell is a family man. I'm a carpenter by trade. I've been an entrepreneur for over 15 years, an educator of skilled trades and engineering technologies. I'm also a counselor for Ward 4. But most important of all, ladies and gentlemen, I am a servant to our community. And that's incredibly important to me. But who am I as a family man? Well, I've been married for 25 years to my wife, Sherry, three lovely pets, but of course, somewhere in there I have two amazing children who have incredibly blessed my lives. Now, I put them in an odd order, but I want you to understand that I grew up with pets, but children replace them that quick. And I've watched them grow into an amazing young lady and an amazing young man. Both continue themselves in education. As a carpenter, ladies and gentlemen, I've been involved in the carpentry since the early 1980s, progressively working my way into the skilled trades and apprenticeship program. From there, I continued to blossom my education, both through the community college level, through apprenticeship programs, and additional business education at Mohawk College. Over the course of time, I took those skills and applied them as an educator for the community college system. At Mohawk College, I teach for the carpentry apprenticeship, construction engineering technician, and technology for the last 13 years. As a counselor for Ward 4, I've been involved in our community for three elected terms to represent the constituents of Ward 4 and to hear the concerns not only of those residents, but to the residents of the city as a whole. Ladies and gentlemen, this is who I am without a tie. Heart is open, honesty, integrity are two very important characteristics for me. Respect of all individuals, regardless of walk of life, regardless of faith, regardless of gender. I have always carried that forward and I will continue to do so. And I say that because it heartened me to know that when people are treated differently because of who they are, I want to make that difference. All of that combined, ladies and gentlemen, is who I am as a person. Why I'm here as mayor will be answered in the next following questions. But to each and every one of you, I want to thank you very much for being here. I look forward to answering your questions.
Candidate Santa Monica. Good afternoon. Thanks for coming. My name is Mike Santama. I'm a former university professor. I taught at Western for a while, then U of T, and went on to work in government and became involved in the private sector. Over the course of my career, I've operated or run large crown corporations, a number of banking institutions, had the largest portfolio of startup technology companies in Canada, which one of our early startups was RIM, and we were able to successfully help that company grow. And in recent years, I've been involved in the city in a number of capacities through the Economic Development Board. I've been on the board of a number of not-for-profits. And over the last 3 years or 4 years, I've been looking at opportunities and building several businesses, not in Brantford, but they've been growing quite successfully. I'm a father of three. One of my children has a doctorate teaching at Ryerson. My son works for one of the banks, and my other son is a cordon bleu chef, so we eat well. The reason I'm here today is because I think there are a lot of things that are challenging in Brantford. For example, transportation, which I'm sure as students you know about, ensuring that we have a fair and equitable tax system, which though I don't think it's necessarily all of your primary concern, it is a concern of senior citizens and working people who live on an average income of about $37,000 a year in Brantford. The other reason I'm here is because I have certain skill sets, which I'll, I guess, address in the first question, that I think would help the city move forward and enable us to bring to resolution a lot of the challenges that have been on the table election after election. Those include boundary adjustments, brownfields, issues associated with First Nations. And I think it's time to bring all of these issues to a conclusion and move forward with rebuilding the city. We want to create jobs so that when you graduate, we can tempt you to stay here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you for inviting me today, and I appreciate this forum that you put up to educate the students. So my name is Mark Littell. I've been born and raised in this area. Last 35 years, I've lived in the downtown core of the city. I've owned and operated my own business, so I understand financial concerns of people, which is one of the main issues that I think is coming forward through this election. I've raised three sons, have a new grandson, all of whom I'm very proud of, and two sons are still in the educational system. I've served as chair of Habitat for Humanity, chair of Christmas Baskets, chair of the Food Bank, chair of the Airport Commission, been on the executive of the Grand Area Development Board. I served 4 years as a city councilor and took a leadership role on several issues, including I led the team of council that secured the south side of Corbin Street for the development of the Laurier Y complex that's coming up. I chaired and was a member of the post-secondary committee that ensured open channels of communication between the universities and colleges, a committee that this council disbanded. I chaired a committee that also initiated discussions at the time regarding the use of Market Square Mall by the university. I chaired the Police Services Board that ensured comprehensive and complete coverage of the downtown area by the Police Beat Unit and a positive relationship with the Special Constable Service. I worked with the university and student government to ensure a fair parking strategy at that time. I supported the I supported the creation of the Universal Bus Pass Program, a transit terminal assessment process that recommended a new transit terminal to support GO Transit. I participated in the first mayor's lunch during orientation week, and I chaired a committee to start getting GO Transit to Brantford. There are several issues that directly or indirectly affect you that I ask you to consider. The spending by this council has been bloating beyond control, and the effect on you is higher rent rates. I love this city, I'm committed to this city, and I've lived here most of my life. I will continue as mayor to support the growth of the downtown and the expansion of post-secondary education, as well as working to attract new venues, including additional housing, entertainment, and retail to the downtown core. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Turmel.
Well, I'm John the Engineer Turmel. I've worn this when I picket banks and when I picket anti-protests, anti-poverty protests. And if you Google for anti-poverty system, you'll find that less software comes up. It's time-based software that allows people to help each other and pay each other with one-hour bills. Simple concept, time banking, right? So anyway, it's spreading around the world. The rise of local currencies is making the news, big news recently. And I started it all when I financed the first Let's 30 years ago. But when I ran in 2010, I had difficulty explaining to people how it could work. So I said in 2010, we're going to call it a bus bucks campaign because I want to pay the kids with bus tickets for empty seats to shovel our snow and clean our parks and do useful stuff like that. Now, I didn't get elected, it didn't get done, but Hong Kong next year used their octopus bus cards to pay their students credits to do work. So it's doable. Their students got jobs, ours can too. So anyway, now since then I've surveyed candidates in the other rides, and we've got Jennifer McDonald in Ward 2 and David Swanson in Ward 5 who support paying students with bus tickets to shovel our snow these upcoming winters. And don't forget, the global warming hoaxers who used the trick to hide the decline in the temperature over the last 16 years probably we're going to get more snow, it's going to be a bad one, and wouldn't it be nice if kids, instead of going on a street corner on a can't go to school, they're closed, could all be out there shoveling our snow for bus tickets, for empty bus seats? Think! This is an idea that can go global. Now, I switched to the bus tickets to explain it to kids how community currency would work because I had difficulty explaining it to adults in the 2007 and 2003 elections where I wanted to pay people with tax credit notes to do work for the city. Same idea. You get prepaid taxes, and that can be traded around to anybody who uses that. Well, so that's what I want to bring to the Brantford election, is I want to bring alternative currency software that allows me to set up a BusBug system on their B cards. Everybody's got their B cards in Brantford. Well, not everybody, but all the kids do. I got mine. Anyway, just like the Octopus Bus card, and these can all be melded together. In other words, if your kid is out there shoveling your driveway getting paid with bus tickets, those bus tickets can be used to pay your taxes because they're using bond bucks. Ah, in Argentina, those tax credits, instead of calling them tax credits, they said if we can issue a bond, a $1 million bond, why can't we issue a $10 bond and pay people with them? So when their bank shut down, and what would you do when your bank shut down? They all started paying their employees with provincial bonds.
Canada, Germany.
Same with Russia. Thanks.
Heard Mayor Christopher Eel.
He's very passionate. My name is Christopher Eel. I'm the current mayor of the city of Brantford. And I've been mayor 13 of the last 20 years. First elected 20 years ago when I was 27 years old. It was a remarkable time. And in that 20 years, we have completely reinvented the city of Brantford and moved ourselves forward into a 21st century community and only looking forward at this point. I'm married to my wife, Wendy, who's seated with us today. I have two teenagers at home. I often point out as I gray that being mayor 13 years did not give me one single gray hair, but teenagers certainly are adding immensely to that. We when I cut the ribbon for Laurier Brantford 15 years ago, we never thought it would grow to the point that it has today. And it was an experiment, it was something new. The municipality paid for a lot of the start of post-secondary, but it's grown beyond what even we expected it. But we can't rest on our laurels, because we are growing, 3,500 population right now, and there are so many other things that we need to start considering. The first one that we need to start working on is communication with the students. We speak well with the administration, but we don't speak as well with the students. And I've had the opportunity to meet with the executive, and we've had that conversation and highlighted a number of opportunities for us to be able to speak more directly to hear what your needs are, your direct needs are. We have to start talking about housing, both students and residents. We have to start thinking about where our next housing projects are going to be in the downtown for students, and at the same time, we have to be conscious of the fact that we can't be pushing residents out and creating a difficulty for them. So we need to find a balance between them, but the campus is going to continue to grow. We have to work the athletic complex, which we negotiated in this term of council, is ready to go and is starting. Market Square, which we also negotiated, is going to be helping with amenities for the students. We have to talk about safety. We initiated a Safe Brantford project, which is a community-based approach, which involved Laurier, James Hughes is there, as well as Brian Rossborough, but we're talking about what specific and situational needs are for safety, which would rely on what students are telling us in the downtown. We have to talk about health and healthcare and access to doctors. We have to start talking about working in an urban campus, streetscape design like we just did with Victoria Park, the retail mix, parking, transit, all of these things that make an urban core. An urban campus, we have to start talking about growth. Where is the campus going to be growing over the next 10, 15 years? And we have to start talking about tying our economic development processes within the city of Brantford with what's happening in post-secondary institutions and what kind of programming we can develop and join together. And the last one that we've worked on is Go Bus Service to Brantford, and it's been very successful. The business plan is happening.
Thank you. Kevin McKay.
Good evening. My name is Mary Ellen Kay, and I moved here in 1997, and I started volunteering at St. Joseph's Hospital right away, taking my guitar around, singing Anne Marie songs, all sorts of different songs. And that's one thing I'd like to recommend to you is get involved in the city. Every city that I've ever been to for university studies, I've been to University of Windsor, Dalhousie University, it's not called Dalhousie out there, it's called Dalhousie in Halifax. In University of Western Ontario for some specialized teachers courses. In music, of course, that's what I was studying years ago. Getting involved in the city, we've got wonderful people in Brantford that I really want you to go out and meet. That's one of the reasons why what I'd like to see is 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, every 30 minutes, transit available to you. And that's the first thing I'd like to get organized in this city, is a good, reliable transit system so that you can, when you come into the city, how many of you, hands up, have a good transit system in the town where you come from? Yes, there's a lot of you. It would be nice if it was integrated within Brantford's transit. 5 o'clock on Sunday, it stops. All sorts of different complaints I've heard from people. And I'd like to improve it. That's the first commitment that I have to you, is transportation. In all the places I've lived, I've never... We've had always an established university that I was in, so it's been nice to be a part of in a city. As a resident, as a school teacher, a university in its beginning phases. So this has been an interesting part to watch me as a resident. I live walking distance from here, and to watch it grow. I've worked with many students in the teaching profession and different students that I've taught at the high schools ended up at Laurier. And they were very glad that they could stay in town and go to school as their first priority. That's one of the other thing that I'd like to say is at each time, safety is a very important issue for me. As a woman, I've also been told many people have crimes, and the safety of walking at night for anyone is something that during this election has been brought to my attention. I am committed to better lighting and pathways all over the city. I am committed to bus shelters and well-lit bus shelters areas so that you can feel safe coming to and from part-time jobs, volunteer positions, visiting friends. Those are some of the many ways that I found it was most helpful when I was at school. So I hope that I'm glad you're here. We're all glad you're here. And we're glad that you're making your beginning of your educational journey with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kim. Take care. All right, so this is the beginning of our question period. For each question, the candidate will have a maximum of 2 minutes to answer the question, and then it will be passed on to the next candidate. If at any point you forget the question that was originally asked, please feel free to ask me, and I will repeat it for you. And so, what is your definition of a mayor, and what is your background that qualifies you for this position?
Perfect. Since I'm not one that's comfortable standing right in front of a mic, and I like to use my instructor/professor's voice, can you hear me down in the back? Perfect. That's great. What is the definition of mayor? Mayor is the ultimate cheerleader in our community. Someone who will stand out and promote all the positive and all the good, reflect the best that we have to possibly answer. But what qualifies me as being a candidate for mayor? I think my act of giving back starts as a very key point. 80 committees and volunteer organizations over the last 30 years. Some as a volunteer, some as an executive member. I know when to boast them and when not to boast them. Today is not one of those days. It's great to be humble and reflect that. I've been an elected 3-term Ward 4 counselor. I've garnered the experience of understanding the roles and responsibilities under City Hall. I've had the opportunity to engage the residents of Ward 4 and throughout the city on a political level. I am a servant by far foremost of the three that I've just now mentioned. The servant being someone who is not afraid to get out and get the job done. I am very results oriented. If you pick up the phone, there is no question and no hesitation that I will go out, I will meet with you, and in some cases, like ice storms, I have no fear of picking up and cleaning up the branches, loading up garbage for residents. So I'm very much an involved and hands-on type person. My father very much used to say, son, you have 2 ears, 1 mouth, and 2 eyes. Some of you are familiar with the cliche of 2 eyes. It's a little bit of an additive. My father used to say, son, 2 ears to listen very carefully with, 1 mouth to ask the questions to learn more, and 2 eyes to see the results of your questions that get answered. I am straightforward. I don't have time for playing games with people's personal lives or here in this community. But I'm also a man of faith. And I think that counts for a lot of what we do.
do in our community, how we trust and treat people.
Thank you, Candidate Rubel. Candidate Armand.
A mayor is probably more than about being a cheerleader. It's about somebody who has the capacity to provide leadership to a community, has the capacity to negotiate with his fellow councillors, has the capacity to draw a consensus, and has the capacity to work with people in order to create an environment in which positive growth will occur. I spent 40 years in business. During the course of that time, what I discovered was that you need certain tools to move forward. I've negotiated transactions, restructuring of Algoma Steel, for example. I've been involved in a number of situations where we've dealt with startup companies like RIM. And I've learned through that process that it's not just having a skill of and a set of financial tools. It's also about the capacity to draw everybody together. With me, what you see is what you get. I'm totally transparent. Sometimes I say things I shouldn't say, and that's too bad. The way I think that we move along is clearly laying your foundations and your beliefs on the table. One of the things that I think needs to be reconciled for granted is Councillor Larry Kings, during the course of the term, said one of the reasons council can't work together is because we can't agree on anything. Well, I think it's the mayor's job to draw that consensus, to get that agreement, to bring people together, and to create a set of working and operational tools that move us forward. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Kind of a little.
Far be it for me to break the trend. As I'm a songwriter, I need the mic. Well, my number one rule in life that I try to follow is to try and treat people the way you want to be treated. And that's the way I do things. I already gave most of my qualifications in my opening, which I hadn't done that remark was there. But I've taken a leadership role on several issues inside this community, both as a volunteer, whether it's through Rotary or Habitat or Christmas Baskets or Food Bank. But my leadership role on council, I believe, was significant. And one of the most difficult roles I took, and unfortunately you weren't here at the time, was that I took on the project and led a team of committed councillors to remove the buildings on the south side of Coleman Street. And those buildings were a problem for 35 years through many mayors, through different councils, that everybody was afraid to deal with it. And I'm glad they're down now, because I think if they weren't down before the start of this last council, they'd probably still be there, and you wouldn't see the why Laurier complex going up. You wouldn't have seen $100 million in new development in this city. A leader is a team builder. A leader is not a one-man show. So I would work together with council, consensus build to get us to the point where we're not bloating beyond control in our spending at this and hurting our taxpayers significantly. So I think the big thing that I would do as a leader is work with the members of council, work with every member of council to try and get things done.
Thank you. Candidate Jermel.
Don't expect me to be a hands-on mayor. If there's a snowstorm, he can help shovel you out, but I have students paying payment bus tickets. So don't expect that. Now, chief executive officer. And qualifications, 98 percentile math, 100% university physics, A electronic engineering fourth year, 4 years teaching assistant of Canada's only mathematics of gambling course. After my career, if you Google for great Canadian gambler, I come up, and I was known as the professor, and every poker game has a guy called the professor who knows the odds. And I was known as the professor at the Taj Mahal in Atlantic City of Rounders fame, if you saw the movie. So, if I tell you there's one way to win out of 10 doing this and two ways to win out of 10 doing that, who's going to stand up and argue with me? Okay? So don't expect politics of the future to be the same as guys who don't have game theory. I can bet I'm right. And that's what you want, the winningest way to go, the least losingest way to go, which happens to be my professional specialty. I'm a professional poker player right now down at the Branford Casino that finances all my elections, all my court activities for the past 35 years, including this software.
Thank you, Candidate Jamel. Candidate Friel.
I'm not a professional gambler, although as a politician and having spent as many years in elections as I have, it probably could be said that I am. The mayor is officially the head of council. The mayor is the leader and the spokesperson. The mayor provides advice and gives direction when working with council. This council has been remarkably effective and for the most part has worked very effectively as a team. And that is right up until the end of this term of council. And having sat in the chair for 13 years, it is very difficult to say that that is the case. A mayor has to have vision, probably more than anything else, because when you get into a council situation, you see a lot of issues related to wards, very specific and situational. You have to leave those issues to the ward councillors. And the mayor has to have direction for the entire city and has to have a vision for the entire city, where it's going to go and what would be best for the community as a whole. A mayor needs to be able to develop relationships with the senior levels of government and with its partners or neighbors as well. And we've done that. As tense as our relationships have been with our neighbors in Six Nations and the County of Brant at times, we've also been able to be there immediately to speak with each other because the relationship has always remained professional and has always been a working relationship, and one that we're very happy about. But we always need to work with the province. And we have to be thinking beyond our borders. And in a world now of global competition, we can't just think, and as a mayor, you can't just think about the community down the highway. You have to start thinking about communities in China and Brazil and all around us, because we are a community in a global world. We have to be there and be part of that global world. So the mayor has to be able to, most importantly, above everything else, have a vision and enact that vision.
Thank you. Candidate Kay.
My name is Mary Ellen Kay again, and my definition of mayor, I've seen mayor, well, my background, I started off as a school teacher working on a little community, building a good community in your classroom. And I was nervous in junior event, I remember. Then that wears off because you build a community within your school. Then you build work as a team to build a school. Over the years, it has grown and it has grown. In my travels, I've traveled to Romania, and one of the most amazing things that I noticed, they had 50 years of communism, that the mayor's office is the one that had to offer a solution. There was persecution going on. People were converting from one religion to another. Their own neighbors were throwing them off their own property. Those people didn't want to have any more problems, so they went to the mayor's office in their city. And unfortunately, in the government that happened, they didn't get their properties back in Medjidia. What they did is had set up a lease for parcel of land outside of the city where they could build up a community for their religious, to build it almost like an Amish farm. And so I was part of that mission trip that went to observe that and to help the entrepreneurism, which over 50 years of communism, you can imagine, that had been beaten out of the country. And so I worked with a bunch of, we had a mission, medical mission, and we had an entrepreneur side of our mission trip. That's where some of the cities where you have disagreements, a mayor's office works to the leadership of all of the citizens. In Brantford, we have several nations around us. We have Six Nations around us, different municipalities. We have Brant County. I believe that I could be a good leader who could work with the other municipalities for the betterment of everybody involved. Thank you.
Thank you, Candidate Kay. Oh, Candidate Anderson.
So I can break the trend again. What makes me a good mayor? I am a peacekeeper at heart by nature. You can Google that, you can find that out, a long history of peacekeeping. Wherever there's some tension, wherever there's discord, I will do whatever I can to listen carefully to all sides, to work together with all sides in an inclusive attempt to make sure you solve the problem. I also like priorities. I'm going to throw out a number you might not agree, but I'll bet if your parents and the women who come to Laurier had the choice of whether or not they were going to have better lit streets on the way back to the residence they live in and a couple of more blue light zones over new sidewalks downtown, they would have chosen the lighting 100% every time. They would have chosen safety every time. What we're talking about is priorities. How do we readjust our priorities? We adjust our priorities as mayor. We adjust our priorities by listening to the people who have an issue, whatever the issue may be, wherever the issue might happen in the city, whatever it may entail, whatever it may involve. First, we listen. We make ourselves available at the proper time and a proper place where people will actually get the chance. Now, whether that's online or in person, doesn't matter. We'll find a way. First, identify where the problems are. Then work together with whoever has the problem to solve the problem. I call it crowdsourced democracy. I know it sounds like a redundancy, but it's real. That's what this campaign has been all about. That's what I am all about. That's what my history has been all about. And I see no reason to change what I've done so far.
Thank you, Councilor Benchel. Candidates, say no more. I guess we're moving to the next question.
If I knew the question, I'd answer it.
Yes, that was good. What is your vision for Market Square now that it is owned by Laurier?
Well, I guess Market Square has been a bit of a contentious issue. My concerns in dealing with Market Square were not with the fact that it went to Laurier, but with the way the transaction was carried out. That's been raised by a number of people. But Market Square, it seems to me, is representative of what's happening to the downtown. We have Laurier, who has an agreement with the city. The city is paying basically for the transaction to occur. The city has given up an asset to Laurier for good. And Laurier is looking to develop Market Square premises over the next 10 years. One of the things that we have to recognize is that the relationship with Laurier is not just a one-way street. I mean, there is a responsibility to do fiduciary work in terms of transactions that go on between Laurier and the city. One of the things that I think is important in terms of utilization of Market Square is that there are people, businesses in Market Square currently who are paying taxes. As Laurier takes over the building, they'll be moving out and we'll lose the property tax base in the downtown area. So I think the strategy going forward has to be built on two things. The first is we have to address the mix of property that creates tax base. I realize my time is up. Got to have taxes in the downtown.
The Laurier discussions began in 2007, and I'm glad that they completed. They're completed. I completely support what has happened. What the advantage of Laurier taking that building is that it's going to free up other properties for business development, for housing stock that normally Laurier would take. For example, the CIBC building, the former adult recreational. Recreation, I guess that would be a good word to use, the strip joint, right? And those other buildings that they've taken. So that's the key thing that's happening there. The problem was the transparency on there. The problem was, why was it done on the last day of council? Why was the deal cut on the day of the mayor's debate? The problem was when the mayor says, I can't tell you the details, you're just going to have to trust us. Well, when we were there, there was no other organization that was interested in it. So it's a wonderful fit for the city. But what are the details that still haven't come out? And even some councillors don't know what the details are. details work. That's the problem I have with it. But it's good for the city, it's good for Laurier, and it's good for the downtown.
Thank you. Kevin, the chairman.
Well, I have to agree, it certainly fits in, but I have more an idea of it as a student center than classes or anything like that. But back to my favorite theme, imagine you could pay part of your tuition by proctoring and cleaning up the Market Center. Imagine you could pay part of your tuition by proctoring the whole campus, policing it, making sure there's no crime and no dirt around. Gee, I'd take Branford Laurier bucks, especially if I can use them on the bus and I can use them to pay taxes. Again, it just goes to show that the basis of all these currencies is always the human time putting in the work to back them up. Even if I trick you into thinking it's a bus seat making this coupon valuable, it's a kid working an hour with a shovel. And if I trick you into believing it's a tax credit that makes you, no, it's the fact you delivered work to get it. And the same thing if I make it, well, no, a babysitting IOU, that's pretty clear. Everybody knows, everybody wants one of those, right? The mechanic wants them. Everybody will take a babysitting IOU. Well, anyway, the point is Jennifer McDonald will take emails for people who want to join the babysitting network, and David Swanson will take emails for people who want to join the shoveling network, because community currency, community service counts in a time bank. When I do accordion concerts, free. Well, no, I get a registered IOU 2 hours of community service. I can either post it at my webpage or get an IOU, a piece of currency that we use in our network. So anybody can do community currency and back it up with useful labor, which becomes a token in our barter exchange. Now, wouldn't it be nice to have the city connected and the bus connected? With all this together, we could set an example for the world on homegrown, local, financial reform.
I wasn't sure how you were going to tie that one in, but that was good. Many of you will not have realized the Market Square, when it was built many, many years ago, actually when I was in high school, and it was built, was part of a program from the provincial government. And the provincial government put these malls, suburban shopping concepts, in the middle of an urban core. And it was doomed to fail because suburban malls are meant to be an island of parking, or an island of shopping surrounded by a sea of parking. And it has been on a steady decline, even since the early 90s, after I came back after university, to the point now where it is virtually empty. So to suggest that there is a loss of taxes of any dramatic number is absolutely false, because there are only a handful of businesses that function in the mall as it stands right now. The mall was purchased for amenities for students. It was made very clear what the reason was. It will be a library. It will be a food court space. I understand that there will be a study space as well. There were a number of options that were presented, and it is probably the best possible use we could have. It's not that we're compromising on the use. This is an exceptional use for that building. It's exactly what we need. And if you consider the fact that there's a $54 million athletic complex being built as we speak, getting ready to finally go be brought up, and then the purchase of both the land, which the city owned, and the head lease from GK York, and ultimately the amount of money that's going to have to go into it, we're going to see tens of millions of dollars of investment in our downtown because of the partnership that we've developed. It was the right decision to make. It was the right time to make the decision. So it's ready for the beginning of September. And it's just another example of the success that we've had in that partnership with Laurier Branford.
Thank you, Captain Friel. Captain K.
Yes, as I'm going door to door in the neighborhoods, I'm hearing exactly the history of that property. Disappointment, trial, and error, back and forth, back and forth. Years ago, when I came to Branford, I was singing with, as an extra soprano, with the Norfolk Singers, Handel's Messiah. And we went to Eaton's as one of our little trips back and forth. And I remember being in that building when it was a shopping center. It was busy. One of the things I'd like to challenge you in this vision is, now that it's in Laurier's hands, I used to be on student council when I was in the University of Windsor, and a student representative at faculty meetings. I would like to encourage you to personally get involved in that vision, what you set the vision for your area. And think about the students that are coming after you. Some of the decisions you'll make, as in student parliament opportunities and even volunteering, that extra time that you take out of your schedule can help shape how the campus looks long after you're gone. Because they're still making decisions that I had suggested as an alumnus, after I've long left the campus. I've had a professor call me to say, Marilyn, I'm glad you brought that up. We haven't followed through with it right away, but just wanted to let you know that suggestion you made is still on the table. So you don't know what kind of a legacy you can leave for this city and for this campus that as it's evolving, as you get involved, personally involved in how Laurier is run. And that's what I would like to encourage you to do, is think about it. When you're thinking about it, one of the things that I've heard from McMaster is that universities can quickly, in the contract section, become almost a fortress. And when people wanted to bring in local food as a supplier for, like, local food, like Brain County has wonderful farmland around it. People in McMaster have complained about that, trying to get local food in the cafeteria. It's like a fortress. So the more you can, there's probably many of you that would like to be involved in business when you're done university. Get involved now. Start asking if you could be on that negotiating team so that food services include local food. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Anderson.
Thank you. Was it a good thing that we basically gave the building to Laurier? Absolutely. We did not use that building properly. It was vacant for far too long. That's a horrible waste of space when people don't have places to live in some cases in Brainerd. Was it the best timing for the deal? Absolutely not. But we ended up with selling our own house without having a place to move into. So we're going to have to pay tens of millions of dollars later on in the future. Again, we're talking about priorities. If this was two different discussions, one about should we give the building to Laurier, I would have said a resounding yes without the hesitation about what's going to cost later on. Again, we're talking about priorities and how things are managed. Another thing that happened in the last 4 years of council, I was surprised to hear that somehow there had been some miscommunication between the leaders of Mohawk College, who also wanted to place themselves downtown but didn't have the opportunity. And in 4 years, I've never had an answer about how that happened. So, is it good use for post-secondary? Absolutely. Beyond a shadow of a doubt. Good use of space in the core? Brilliant. Did we get the best deal for our money as a city? I'm not convinced that we did. What would I do to change that? Well, it's going to happen. You've seen reuse and rebuild and reconstruction of one building after another in the core, and they look great. I trust Laurier. Laurier does good work as far as infill. That's what we do here in Brantford. We do infill. Laurier does really good work. I trust Laurier. It'll be a great use of space. I know that for certain. However, how do we get to make these sole source decisions? When we honestly talk about what our responsibilities are to the taxpayer, we should probably try to get the best bang for our buck. If there were other interested parties, perhaps we could have looked at keeping the trade schools in Brantford as well. Just a thought.
Thank you, Candidate Vandersel. Candidate Rebel.
If I can I get a clarification on the question? Vision for
yes.
Market Square.
What is your vision for Market Square now that it is owned by Laurier?
Perfect. You can dream it. You can own it. You can share it. It's about engagement between your administrators, your faculty, and yourselves. That's where the program starts, and that's the direction you need to take. And I believe you're already starting in that direction right now. I know when the initial sale was done, that was exactly some of the conversation, which is quite interesting, the question that was just being proposed, and I just received an email less than 3 minutes before the question was answered. And here are some comments from your alumnus who graduated this past year. Great uses for the downtown core in a general. I'm going to paraphrase what they've done for that particular area. One, food court. Some places they can access affordable food, quick and easy, for them right on campus facilities. Two, more parking. If there's available land outside the back of the building and the premise, more parking, and gosh darn it all, I think the word was free, OMG, make it free. I think there's other parts that they mentioned in here, the use of a library, something that's close and accessible for all students and a large common area for students to have interactive social networking. But those are things you folks get the opportunity to decide. Where does the city get an opportunity to play a role? By coming cutting through the bureaucratic red tape that's going to allow your administrators and your faculty and your student unions and your student body to work together to develop those plans, to get the permits to do what's necessary, to get the zoning maybe necessary where there may be changes required. That's where we as a government now commit to play to help you fulfill your dreams.
Thank you, Candidate Ribble. The next question is, what role do you envision yourself playing in helping to improve the relationship between the Brantford and Six Nations communities? Candidate Ribble.
I say
Littell.
That's okay. That's fine. Well, I have to say that right now the relationship between the Six Nations and Brantford is very poor. There's no communication going on right now. One of the platforms that I'm going to use later, and I'll just talk about it now, in the Six Nations have a person working right inside the elected chief's office as a liaison that provides information. And I would recommend that council appoint somebody to work inside the mayor's office, reporting directly to council, so that that person can keep the Six Nations and the Grand County informed of what we're doing, so they've got no surprises. There would be a straight line communication level between that. And that's what we need to do. We need to get our communications improved significantly with the Six Nations and the county for that matter. And that's one way of doing it.
Thank you. Candidate Turnbull.
Well, it's difficult to do a deal when both sides don't have enough money. And obviously, it's easier to do a deal when both sides have enough money. Now, of course, we're paying an extra $1.5 million in interest on the debt this year, and many more millions as well, which we could save if we were to switch to an alternate currency. Now, we could show them how to do it too, except they used to do it already. 200 years ago, Indians could pay for stuff with wampum beads. An IOU worth a horse or a beaver pelt or something. Even the whites took it. And somehow or other, the whites then came over and talked the Indians into giving up their local wampum currency and getting into the unemployment lineup with the white guys. Imagine that. They had their own alternate currency, and now maybe we can talk them into starting up their own, so they also won't be short of currency in doing their negotiations with us. It's the same thing with the boundary negotiations. When I got here in 2003, what about the boundary negotiations? And in 2006, next election, in 2010, and again this year, what about boundary? Can't you guys agree after 11 years? No! Nobody can take the cut because nobody's got enough money. Now, that's my point. If both organizations start saving all that interest, and the only victims of community currency are the banks. If we stop using bank licensed by the government for money and create our own, the only people who get hurt are the banks because they're losing the interest. And if we're all saving it all, everybody who does this alternate currency locally, it's got to be easier to come to deals and negotiations.
Thank you, Candidate Turnbull. Candidate Friel.
The relationship between Brantford and Six Nations was very, very poor when we came in this administration after dealing with injunctions and protests. And we have worked diligently to change that relationship, and it is on the right track. We did work towards having tri-council meetings, which was all of the councils, all the councillors from the City of Brantford, Six Nations, and County of Brant meet, and it was a good learning experience. In fact, the best session we had was at Six Nations, where we learned about their funding mechanisms, they learned about our funding mechanisms, and what we learned, most importantly, was that we have very little communication amongst ourselves, but only because they speak to the federal government and the provincial government, and we speak to the municipalities. We have no relationship that assists us to be able to have that contact-to-contact or that neighbor-to-neighbor relationship with Six Nations, and it's been unfortunate. So what have we done? Well, in the last 4 years, and one of the things that has been troublesome is that we talk and we talk and we talk, and we've been doing this for years, and the federal and provincial governments want us to talk and talk and talk because there's no resolution then. But this council went with Six Nations. We went up to Ottawa. We lobbied the federal government. We met with each of the parties and said, get here, there's three parties, or there's three bodies that want to work together, but we need you to help us. We did the same thing with the provincial government, AMO, in this last session, which is the Association of Municipalities of Ontario. I said to the deputy minister, we need you to come to Brantford. The last month, the deputy minister met with the chief, Mayor Eddy, and myself, and we talked about the same things. We need you to help us talk. We need you to allow us the tools as a municipality to be able to do that. And Six Nations agrees, and we have been meeting and discussing that item ever since. We will, in the next term of council, continue with our lobbying efforts, and we will create that relationship that is respectful of neighbors, but then recognizes the fact that we function and work on different levels of government.
Thank you, Candidate Friel. Candidate Kay.
One of the things that I'd like to work on is communication. I believe you don't need to hire somebody separate for that. We've had it at the committee level. When I was serving on the Brownfields Community Advisory Committee, we had somebody serving on our committee who was from Six Nations representing some of the ideas, and she would take back and forth some of the ideas, but it didn't go back. We didn't have somebody on their side to, so we could glean that information as well. There's a number of problems that we need to work on together. One of them is a crime rate. I've heard from people, one of the ideas that I would like to develop, working with all the communities that hasn't been mentioned, is developing a long-term, multifaceted approach to help people overcome addiction, to help people overcome substance abuse, mental health, difficult housing, and socioeconomic reasons that all play into a difficult time for people in Brantford and surrounding areas. In the old days, when people would, almost Bible times, when you were struggling, there used to be areas where you could go up to the areas of a farm and they would leave food for you outside there if you were poor. Nowadays, the people migrate to a city. And in a city, we have the opportunity where we share resources to reach out and help people, where out in the county, you can't do that. And that's when I go around, I see there's so many services that Brantford has that I would like to see grow and have that communication between all three areas, whether it's addictions counseling, whether it's housing, and that communication to recognize that Brantford plays a central role in providing a lot of those. And affordable housing is one of the first things I want to get up and off the ground, because there's so many people when I go door to door looking for affordable housing. Thank you.
Thank you, Candidate Kay. Candidate Benderson.
All right, it's going to be fun for me. Have you ever seen any protests in the county of Brant while they built one industrial subdivision after a commercial subdivision after a residential subdivision from either the concerned citizens of Brant, from the men's fire, from the women's fire, from band council, from the Haudenosaunee, from the HDI, from the Confederate chiefs? Have you ever seen any protests in the county of Brant? Nope. Any work stoppages? No. They're just on the other side of the river. Matter of fact, if you're standing on Oak Park Road where Brantford had a whole lot of trouble, and you look over the river, you can see Rest Acres Road. You can see the development. No problem. Never. Ever. Why? County of Brant signed an accord with Six Nations. What do we have in Brantford? We have an injunction, we have lawsuits, and we put up land for tax sale. Not just one, probably about four. Why do you think we have problems in Brantford when the county does not? Why do you think we didn't go on our second trip to lobby in the province and lobby in Ottawa to try to get responsible governments together? Why do you think that cohesive group kind of fell apart? The tribe council? Wait a minute. The county already gets along with Six Nations people, and there's no argument. What's the city doing there? Who does the city argue with? The city argues with the county, and the city argues with Six Nations on a regular and consistent and hopeless basis. So, you can believe anything else you hear in the room, but I ask you to question that. Why is it that there's one group that doesn't seem to have any problem whatsoever? Why do we have so many problems? I'll tell you why. We don't treat people equally. We need an inclusive approach, a respectful approach, that listens to all the voices, similar to the students. Students, you know, listen, solve problems.
Thank you, Candidate Bamberstow. Candidate Roby.
I hope I can have as much fun as Jan just did. I think one of the key issues we're doing is we're not listening to people. of six nations. We're not asking the right questions. We're taking the opportunity, maybe we're judging because of injunctions versus no injunctions. Individuals, when you blame them for an unsigned bylaw and they stand on the peripherals and see that, that's not appropriate, ladies and gentlemen. That's antagonistic from their point of view. It's exceptionally important to make sure you listen. And I mean listen carefully, because they have concerns that go just beyond dollars and cents. There's a recent court decision that says duty to consult. What does that mean? Take the time to talk with them about these developments that we're doing in our community. Take the time to involve them in the discussions. We want to talk about boundary negotiations. You know they're going to be part of that process, even though it's a governance issue. They still want to be involved and included, so include them. Council passed a resolution that said that the mayor organized three tri-county council meetings a year. I believe we've only had three, maybe four, in the course of this term. When you don't follow through, regardless of the reason, it creates a wall. There's an expectation that needs to be dealt with, and we need to follow through. Consistency in building relationships is incredibly important. We need to get back to those grassroots. Don't blame, don't accuse, don't judge, quiet, listen, ask the right questions, and be involved with everybody.
Thank you, Kevin. Kevin, say it alone.
Some time ago, I was involved in the land negotiations for the Peterson government, transferring the Tsumwaki lands to the Bearlands in Northern Ontario. That process was quite successful. What had happened to make the process work was that the government, the Tsumwaki community, and the Bear Clan actually worked together with the assistance of the federal government to close that transaction. It wasn't built on a transaction that came out of acrimonious, although in the theater of people chaining themselves to the red pines and Tsumwaki because they didn't want the forest cut. What we discovered was that if you open up the dialogue and the community plays a role, the First Nations play a role, and the government plays a role, and keep the thing transparent. I mean, one of the problems we have in the process of negotiation is that people get wrong messages. You stand there, you hear something, Jan has a story, Chris has a story. They're different stories on the same issue. What we have to do is take a look and sit down with the First Nations. There are things locally we can do, and I agree with Jan that we should have an inclusive process. But the other thing that we need to do is, like when you negotiate, I was involved in Algoma Steel. There was the labor union on one side, there was management on the other, and in the middle was my organization trying to get an agreement. The way we got the agreement was by making things transparent to both sides and talking and clearly outlining where we wanted to go. And the union actually bought 35% of Algoma Steel as a result of that transaction.
Thank you. The next question. How do you plan on approaching downtown recycling initiatives? What are your thoughts on introducing a green bin composting system to bring? Starting with Canada Jamel.
Well, if I ever had heard of a great idea for spending bus bucks or bond bucks, that's it. Pay people to do it. Actually, haven't they trained dogs in some municipalities to pick up bottles and bring them into the machine to get a treat? Surely we could train humans to do it and go pick up a reward, right? A bond buck or a tax credit. So it's a perfect example of a need for a community currency that could really solve the problem completely.
Thank you. You gotta take more time than that, John. Don't get a chance to write anything down. Downtown garbage and recycling is an issue. It's funny, I was watched somebody today taking out their garbage just around noon. And thinking that's going to sit there all day and all night, and
it's going to have the opportunity to be kicked around, ripped, and the garbage is going to fly. Market Street is probably the best example of where we have these problems. And we need to look at how we're dealing with garbage. Now, we had a proposal, which will be reinstated or brought back again in the next council, which was underground garbage receptacles, which are called Morlocks. And you take them, you wouldn't even notice, they look like a garbage can. But underneath is this facility where you can take your garbage, your recycling, all of it can be managed. It's meant for urban cores. It's meant for even park spaces. A very effective tool, and it's been used well in other communities. It's being recommended by our staff, and it's something that we have a great deal of excitement about seeing done. The green bin proposal, so you're talking about wet composting material, we actually tried that in the last contract for our garbage pickup. We put it in, we sent it out, and nobody bid for it. The difficulty that we're going to have is, and we need to do this as municipalities, because I sit on the large urban caucus for the Association of Municipalities of Ontario, and I've had this conversation 2 weeks ago with other mayors talking about green, because they're struggling with the same concept. We need a little bit of assistance from the province to be able to get this going. But every municipality in Ontario should be moving towards a green bin system, so that every bit of waste opportunity that comes out of your home, out of your apartment, out of where you're living, where you're working, is being either recycled, brought into a proper garbage or landfill site, they always say when I say dump, landfill site, and we're managing and we're separating and we're taking as much out and diverting as much as possible. It still works. And we should be moving towards it much more effectively.
Thank you, Candidate Fritz. Candidate Kay.
Yes. I'm glad to hear that there's a staff recommendation on this issue, because walking down the street, it's always been a problem with garbage along the side of the streets. And I'd like to see that. So I'll be looking at that as well, and continuing off with what Candidate Frail is saying. When it comes to the green bins, I hear exactly across the city, one of the issues in Hamilton is educating the community itself, that once you've committed to this is where the garbage is, this is where the recycles are, this is where the green bin is, training the people, all of us, to take ownership of our paper, of our trash, and putting it exactly where it's belonged, because it is a complicated matter in other municipalities like Hamilton that does have it running, is keeping, when the company picks it up, is what's in that bag really what's in that bag, or have people mixed pop cans amongst the green garbage? So helping to train the community to be vigilant, so that when the services do come in, that's one of the areas that I would be most astringent with, is because it is a problem to make it so that we're all compliant with this, and that we've all bought into this idea. Because somebody on a company to sort it through, they're not going to want that contract if they think that the citizens are going to be sloppy in that sorting part of it. So that's one of the things when I watch at Toronto and Hamilton, how the city handles that. Coming from an education field, I know how much education is needed so that everybody can be on board and follow suit with it. Thank you.
Thank you, Candidate Kay. Candidate Benderson.
We already have the money to run the program. We just need to be able to hire a company that'll do it. And I'll tell you where the money is. When you go to the municipal landfill site and you drop off your tree or your skid from your company, what they do is they build piles and piles and piles of them every year, grind them all up before they throw them in the fitting face. Which doesn't make any sense. There's so many other uses for it. Point number two. What we do on our tipping phase is we cover whatever the garbage was for the day with clean fill from another site. Don't need to do it. Other municipalities don't do it. They cover it with a tarp and go at it the next day. There are so many savings we can find, especially when it comes to reuse recycling. It's incredible what we throw out as a society. It's embarrassing. What I'm seeing is a green recycling, a recycling, and a garbage disposal system that is in its infancy in Brantford. You have to get them to do something 40 times before you know whether or not it actually works. So when we decide how we're going to do what we do, we have to ask people, where and when are you going to use these services? Start with the people, start with the existing businesses, start with the ever-increasing uses in the core and intensification. This is what we do now, so we better get used to, you know, cleaning up afterwards. 32 restaurants in the core and a couple of other different types of businesses serving different types of clientele in the city. We need to listen to them. We need to find out when they do, what they do, and how to augment that. We shouldn't come up with a plan that arbitrarily says, well, this is where it's going to be, that's where it's going to be, this is when it's going to get picked up, and this is the format it's going to take. No, it's an interactive, and it's an ongoing interactive dialogue that needs to happen to find out, and first of all, identify where the problem areas are, and keep identifying problems as the core fills with more and more and more people.
Thank you. Candidate Robel.
Yes, the first question is to the students here at Laurier, do you have a recycling program here on campus? And so there's one place we need to start. Start within our own homes. And that could be at student residence, could be on campus facilities. Let's start the recycling programs that are there. Our students, you folks, are the best leaders we could possibly have. Leaders by example, the ones who speak out the loudest with regards to the concerns of our environment, come from you. We need your guidance and sometimes your push. Your push can be a little bit harder. Start here in our own core with drop receptacles that are there for the students, there for the faculty. Look at a core program that starts something small with regards to the green bin recycle. Create those locations, specific and safe, and I think utilizing the industries that are here in the core will help us guide through that process. But if we can start with a small area and drive a program with the help of the students by being the loudest voice we could possibly have and spread that out into the community, I think that's the fastest way to get things done. I think that's an encouraging way to get things done, and that's the way to engage this university, this student, to this student body to become engaged and part of our community, not just a student who's here for 8 months. The students who are here beyond that. And I think that gives you a stake in our community. You become a viable shareholder to us as a municipality.
Thank you. Candidate St. Amant.
A couple of years ago, I did a tour of a number of cities in Europe. And what we were looking at was how the cities interacted on their environmental programs. What we saw were communities that no longer became involved in landfill, but they transferred all of the waste that was developed, and they were responsible for all the waste that was enclosed within that community, and they turned them into a whole range of things. It produced energy that serviced the community. They produced new goods out of the products that were waste. The lumber was redistributed and reassigned to new projects. They chopped up the plastic. For the city, that became a source of revenue, which covered the cost of the recycling programs, covered the cost of the management of waste program, and also generated some revenue to which helped reduce the cost to taxpayers. I mean, that's the sort of forward thinking that we need for the 21st century. It's not continue to dump stuff into a landfill because it's convenient and you've got a landfill. And I would suggest that that's certainly one of the things that Brantford should be looking at for the future. And it's a working relationship that First Nations would accept. It's a working relationship that the county would accept as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Littell.
Thank you. The problem with going last is all the good comments are made, but I'll try a couple there. The big problem that I see in the downtown, firstly, is the garbage is sitting outside at all hours of the day. And we have to come up with some sort of enforcement so the garbage can't be put out before midnight and it has to get picked up before 6 a.m. I rode my bike every day this summer, and all the time I'm coming through, there's garbage sitting out there. The skunks and the other animals have been at it. So that's the first step we have to take. In regards to the green issue, it's not enough interest yet. Not enough interest from the residents. Not enough interest from people that are going to pick it up. So maybe this would be an area that could be a project that the Laurier students themselves could undertake and develop a Green Walks program to get us going. Personally, the people I've talked to about it, that I've been knocking on doors, what they're saying is they don't want the stuff sitting around smelling for a week. The residents are stuck with a downtown area and once a week pickup. So they even try it every 2 weeks pickup. They have that stuff sitting around, that's going to be a problem. But I would be very much in support of a green program starting with maybe the downtown core.
Thank you. The next question is, will any of your new policies or initiatives help reduce homelessness and levels of poverty, and how so? Beginning with candidate freedom.
I actually have to clarify something which is off topic, but the wood that goes into the Brantford landfill is in fact sold. There's a company that takes that land, that wood, and is using it as a recycling. That relationship actually happened at the President's, Laurier President's Council. An individual who sat on that council was a chance meeting. We arranged the contacts, and they're taking all of that wood now out of the landfill area. When it comes to new policies, we initiated this year, particularly the Neighborhood Hubs program, working towards the inclusion component of Smart Brantford. We put in a detox rehabilitation center we found the funding for. And all of these, and we're working towards a healthy Brantford initiative. All of these initiatives get to the root causes. What we've done in the past, we've always just managed. We've thrown money at problems and we've just managed. Names change, new projects come in, the province changes a program, brings something else in, and we just manage. And it doesn't change anybody's life. What we wanted to do with these new programs, particularly the Neighborhood Hubs program, which was actually reviewed by a Laurier professor, was to get to where the individuals are, where they're living. It's based around schools, it is on the streets, and it's involving them, and it's been wildly successful already. So we get to the kids, we get to their families, we start working on resumes, all of these things that we haven't had the opportunity to deal with. But quickly, the one thing that we need to start working on is food desert. A food desert is a part of a community where there is no grocery store, and individuals have to leave their community to be able to shop. What it means for a single mother of two or three young children is that she's shopping at a convenience store. High cost, exceptionally low nutritional value, and we're not producing quality foods. Community gardens are also a really effective way to be able to change people's food effective patterns.
Candidate
K. Well, I've seen community gardens, and I'm a volunteer, and I'm a person who believes in Friendship House, and I know that there's a place, and across this city there are a lot of volunteer opportunities that people in Laurier can help out with. Friendship House, 100 meals a day are served to people in our community. St. Jude's, right down the street. They could use people to help out. The whole basement is filled at the end of their praise and pizza with people that are needed. And what I hear from the people when I go to those dinners is when they heard my platform, just they had seen me, and they come up and say, I recognize you from the newspaper. You're actually standing up for people like me. And I had tremendously good feedback on my transit idea. Every 30 minutes, round the clock, 7 days a week. Because the median income for people in Brantford, 2011, the Stats Canada, it was $28,916. For men, it's $35,976. And for women, it was $23,833. That's where people are at. So transit's one of those initiatives, because this is the working poor as well. When you're going around and you're driving and you have people that need to take care of your children while you get a job working somewhere. When I'm on the transit system, I see parents come, pick up their kids, they go back, they have to get back on the transit, go to their job, work a full day, come back, take a different transfer, go pick up their kids, and then go home. They're exhausted. So my plan of transportation automatically helps ease that burden back and forth, because on that income, you can't really maintain a car. And so my plan already with the transit helps them already where they're at, the dignity of work, getting to and from work, taking care of their families with the job that they have. That's where they're at right today. Thank you.
Thank you, Candidate Vanderson.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we will never eradicate homelessness. We will never completely stop it from happening. In many cases, it's because it's a choice, an individual choice. Those choices are often made by people who choose that for so many different reasons. Will we ever completely eradicate hunger? No, we won't. I think the poor we will always have with us. So what are our options? What are our responsibilities? What I found in the past that a lot of the responsibilities would fall on the church to feed the poor, to house the poor, to clothe the poor. That balance is shifting over time and moving back and forth. What we need now is the type of communication that respectfully supports and upholds natural born community leaders, whether or not they are part of a religious organization or a service group, whatever it may be, and work with them, provide them the facilitate and provide them the tools that they need in order to be able to serve more people. I don't think it's something that we'll be able to do anything other than manage as the amount of homelessness or hunger increases in Brantford, because it will. Our responsibility is going to have to rely on those relationships that we build with other service partners within Brantford, other groups, other individuals who know what they want to do for the community, who are passionate about serving the community, and stand beside and with those community partners across the entire city in a more global perspective of what the needs are. Identify, work with, and solve problems. That's the only way we will be able to do it on an ongoing basis and on an increasing basis.
Thank you. Kevin Rodin.
Thank you. I see this as an opportunity for the private community, the public community, the faith-based community to organize themselves in such a fashion as to reduce some of the redundancies in the services that we offer. We overlap one another, and we overlap one another quite well. And yet that overlap creates I'm going to go to A, don't get what anything A, go to B, go from B to C. All of a sudden you find that person who's struggling for food or for shelter to fall through those gaps. So some way, bringing back a unified program or a unified center to assist those individuals to get the help that they need. Now I want to be careful about the words I use, because there's handouts and there's hand-ups. We have to discern ourselves as individuals how we do that. Handouts work well, don't solve the problem. They don't address the key issues that individuals go through and why they are the way they are and what is affecting their life and their lifestyle choices. But a hand up makes a world of difference. Help them understand themselves. Give them a sense of self-worth. Give them some dignity. Don't judge them for who they are or where they've come from. If they need help on education, get them the help that they need. Encourage them to find ways to step out of the hole or the rut that they fundamentally put themselves in or have fallen in and can't get out because they don't have the tools. And yet we have the tools. Not just we as government, but we as a community have the tools within the services and the organizations there. I use a great one, it's the Yes Church with the Out of the Boat program. It's temporary housing, it's temporary food for those individuals. But as they come in, they provide the counseling services to give them that hand up. And I think we're missing that opportunity, ladies and gentlemen. I think we need to pull it together to come up with one solution.
Thank you. Karen did say them on.
I'm on the board of directors for Rosewood House, and I've been on the board of directors for the Seniors Resource Center at Brantford. And one of the things that strikes me is that in order to service people in the community, government itself does not necessarily have the expertise, but we've created this group of not-for-profits, of organizations who are dedicated and want to focus on addressing the types of issues that we've talked about, the food banks, the housing, the assistance for subsidized housing, transportation. But if we're going to get at the core of the problem, I don't think the answer lies in let's have government do it. I think the more effective way of approaching the problem is to help those not-for-profits in an organized way. And the problem is, the not-for-profits are out trying to raise money, and they're in a competitive marketplace. I've tried raising money for a number of not-for-profits, and you always go to the same people, and if you catch them at the right time, you get some money. If you don't catch them at the right time, you're out of luck. Then you go to city council and look for some funding. That funding is provided for projects. It's not provided for operating costs. Well, the problems that not-for-profits have are operating costs. So I think we need to relook at the way we're addressing the issue of not-for-profits. And I'd point out, too, there's a whole raft of people that are just above the not-for-profit, or the people in need, and that's the seniors living on fixed incomes. If they max out their pension, if they max out old age security, their total income is $18,000 a year. I met a gentleman last night who told me that working for temp companies, his pay is $800 a month.
Thank you.
That's just so work.
Can I live it up?
Thank you. I believe that our social services department in the city hall does a very good job. It's very expensive. It's a burden on the taxpayers, but they're doing the functions that they perform. People are going to always fall through the cracks, and when that falling through the cracks occurs, the private sector picks it up. Not the private sector, the not-for-profit sector picks it up. And I think the not-for-profit sector is doing a very good job. As a member of a service organization, there was a need that our Rotary Club recognized, and I happened to have the privilege of going to Thailand to see a project that our club had done to provide fresh drinking water to 11 schools where the kids had to walk to school sometimes 6 miles carrying their water because it wasn't safe. They don't have to do that anymore. The Under the Cold program in Brantford does a good job of doing that, and other not-for-profit organizations do that. The people that don't want to be found, as Jan alluded to, aren't going to be found, but they know they have a place to go, and I think we're doing a reasonably good job of it. I don't see very many people sleeping on the streets.
Candidate Jamal.
Well, if you go to my website, johnturmel.com, you'll find videos, and if you YouTube for Bus Bucks, you'll find out how in Argentina, they found that humble people, unemployed, given the opportunity to offer services to these big barter fairs where they use their little paper créditos, 1 hour bills, enables them to find something useful to do. Walk your dog, water your plants, read to a blind person. When they say the poor will always be with us, they don't even know what poverty is. Do you know what poverty is? Scarcity. Well, that's a bad crop, wipes out all the apple trees, okay? That's scarcity. What about poverty? Poverty wiped out the money trees, right? Oh, we got no money. Money trees got wiped out. Poverty. Poverty is an artificial shortage of money created by the banking system, who lend everybody 10 in principal and demand they all pay back principal plus interest, 11, creating a mortgage, in French meaning death gamble, where someone always comes up short, poor, and gets knocked out of the game. So yes, the poor will always be with you if I don't get elected mayor. But if I do, and I have sufficient money to reward them for their contributions, that everybody can do something useful, guess what? Maybe they didn't call me the anti-poverty engineer for nothing. Google for it.
Thank you, Candidate Lima. The next question is, one of the major deterrents for students who are coming to Laurier Brantford is the issue of safety. What would you tell parents of prospective students in regards to your efforts to improve downtown safety? Beginning with Candidate K.
The safety and well-being of everyone in our community is of utmost importance to me. One of the ideas that I would tell parents is one of the first things I will say is, and as a mayor, is so many times people make poor decisions for your own safety and for the well-being of others when they relax when they're away from home and they start and they drink, they get into all sorts of different substances, And that's what I noticed when I was off at university. I was shocked at university my first year. I just couldn't believe it. One of the things that I would say as your mayor is I would be encouraging the message of stay sober and stay safe. You have a duty and responsibility to your fellow classmates and to the people within this community to stay sober and stay safe. That impacts your own well-being right away. Because when I was at school, it was in first year university, it was our own brother dorm that there was a horrible group rape that had occurred that first year. What a shocker that it was my own fellow students who I had been to class with that were the culprits, and the city police had to handle that. Campus police didn't handle anything that serious. So that's one of the reasons why I ended up getting involved in student government, is because it does, the more you are active as a citizen, the more you encourage the stay sober, stay safe part. Because people, when they're under substance abuse, they make horrible decisions. They might be happy for a little while, but then we all know that there are other decisions that they make that hurt the well-being of others. When I was with the downtown cleanup down on, and yes, I volunteered for Out of the Cold. I was on the 4 a.m. to 8 a.m. shift, so I do know what it's like to see people in that part. Downtown, we did the, yes, I'll stop in a second. I'm just going to say this, though. This year, when Tracy Bucci took her group out, there was double the amount of needles we picked up in the same part between Larne Bridge and the ICOM building. Twice as many in the downtown cleanup than it had ever been before. Thank you.
Candidate Vanderstel.
Thank you. I think we do a fairly decent job of security in the court with beat cops. I think we could increase that. Longer hours, more officers. I think we do a fairly decent job of working with Laurier with blue light zones and the lighting in the court. I don't think that's so much of an issue as the two following issues. How do you send your girls safely from, or your daughters, your sons, how do you send them safely from the court to where they live? Are they safe along the way? I don't know. I beg to differ that, you know what, we probably need to listen to the students, find out where they're traveling more often, find out what it is that they are afraid of. We could try to figure out what the fear is, what the fear factor is, but without listening, we don't know. What is it that you need to have done to make you feel safe? Conversation a little while ago, parking garage is not safe. I'm not going to use it. I'm not going to get out of my car alone on any level and make it over to Laurier because I don't feel safe. Okay, there's an identified problem. Now, to a 6'4" man, 280 pounds, I'm not afraid, but it's different. It's completely different. Never ask someone to rationalize their fear. Are they afraid? Yes. Are there many people afraid? Yes. Are they afraid of their traffic, their transit from the core to where they live in ever-increasing concentric circles around the core? Yes. How do we manage that? How do we listen? And how do we address it? Number two, housing. Does every single student have safe egress getting in and out of their property? Do they all have safe and secure premises? Can they fall? Can they get hurt? Is there a working CO2? Is there a working smoke detector? Who inspects this stuff? Who looks after it? Do the parents call to find out whether or not it's properly managed property? I say we've got thousands of eyes on the ground that can tell us where the problems are. That's what these are for. So I say, open the lines of communication. Let the students tell us where we need to solve problems. And do it.
Thank you. Candidate Rubel.
If we're going to talk to parents, both as community leaders and as faculty members and as administrators, why be in Brantford, why it's safe, and why is it a good place to be for your student, be it your daughter or your son. And we need to look at the fact, knowing what Laurier has on their service side. Security cameras in the corners in areas where traffic is high or even concealed traffic where it's difficult to have great vision or great access to it. Two, increased emergency poles. Do we have safety poles where we can watch over and tap a button and have that communication directly with an officer or a foot patrol while that incident may be taking place for it to avert that incident that's taking place as a quick cautionary measure? These are things we want to be able to tell our parents that these exist. We have existing foot patrols. We have buddy programs. where we walk in partners, where two individuals will walk together with one female student or a couple of male students, and they will walk to their destination, and they will walk in partners. We use that at Mohawk College. It's an incredibly effective program. And I would encourage parents to look into our colleges and universities and say, hey, this is what we offer for our students' safety. We have our own special constables. We have access to our regular police force. They're all here. We have city safe houses. Let's create some safe businesses that are operating on a 24-hour basis. Let's have them identified. Let's create additional lighting instead of just soft ambient lighting that's attractive. Let's create brighter areas. Let's limit confined or concealed spaces. Let's try to design places where things are more open, where visibility is very clear. Yes, it's nice to have shady trees, but if you walk through Victoria Park and you walk close to a tree, it becomes an off-the-beaten path. It becomes a fearful situation. So let's try to educate our students in what it is. And we do that as students. We want to do that as faculty. We want to educate our students. So I would say we've created processes in place that help you be comfortable with your students' well-being. That's how I would look at that.
Thank you. Kevin, does it say to our mom?
One of the things that I've experienced in Brantford, we've been the victim of vandalism several times down in my neighborhood. And when you call the police, you know, they come to take a statement and they go off looking for the perpetrators if they can find them. You never do, it seems. The approach that we've taken in our role community is sort of our neighbors watching over each other. Secondly, I'd have to agree with Jan and Dave that the approaches they're talking about also make sense. But the other thing we have to really address is crime doesn't occur in a vacuum. And maybe what we should be doing, if it's drug-related, or if it's car theft, is to encourage the police to get much more aggressive to find the source of the problem. The problem is not always the people that use drugs. The problem is the people bringing them to the city and making them available. And, you know, I've always been a proponent of you got to cut the source off. And maybe that's in addition to providing additional security in the downtown core. We should encourage our police department to become much more focused on addressing the issues of the sources. Thank you.
Thank you. Karen,
It's all right. What's paramount here is the safety of the students and also the residents of the downtown. When you have 17, 18-year-old boy, young man and young women coming down here, that's what's important. The areas that are problem areas, lighting, we can look at video surveillance. When there's events going on, I was just at a large concert in Memphis, the police have a flashing blue light, and the blue light's videotaping what's going on, so we can use that situation. But what I'm really committed to is full support for a full beat patrol in the downtown core, and that's the answer.
Thank you. Candidate Turnham.
Well, I already mentioned the solution to the security problem with more proctors paid for with tuition credits, right? You could have two students walking through the parking garage. Solves that problem with a camera. I mean, the point is, if you start up your own local currency system, you can do things yourselves. Can't be done if you got to wait for outside money, okay? It's been done before, we can do it too. Now. Well, again, what's wrong with having more proctors? And does anybody in the place object to some students paying their tuition by policing campus? Anybody think that's a bad idea? I know you're not going to vote for it, but do you think it's a bad idea paying some students their tuition to be the proctors of our campus? You get the general response? Everybody seems to like the idea of giving these students jobs paid for with university credits. Why not try and get it organized?
Can it be real?
Oh. Okay. That was all. Thank you. Just some time.
I'm going to speak quickly, so I hope you can keep up. We have to be conscious of the fact that although security is an issue for students in the downtown, security and safety issues are actually citywide. So we can't look at it in isolation because there is coming and going. People are not going to say, I'm only a criminal in the downtown, etc. We have to think about this on a community-wide level, which is most important. And we did this. I mean, there's been a lot of talk, but we've acted. And the action that we took was we implemented through a broad-based community program, literally hundreds of people involved in this in the early stages, the Safe Brantford Initiative. And the Safe Brantford Initiative is meant to draw together community groups, individuals, come up with community-led initiatives for safety. And we went so far in council as to approve $500,000 from casino funds to pay for a coordinator who has been hired and is getting ready to work on that process. We have to identify crime comes predominantly from three areas: addiction, mental health, and poverty. We are putting in place a detox rehabilitation center to start to deal with the addiction problems, which are probably the number one reason for crime in any community. We're working on a mental health program and initiative. In fact, the symposium will be happening within a couple weeks because we were trying to deal with the health concerns related to it. And the other part of it is that there are university professors from Laurier who are working with us, both on the crisis table from Safe Brantford, who are reviewing it and are working on the mental health initiative as well. And reviewing all of those initiatives. So we've been doing a great deal. What we need to do now is get it on the street and make it part of what you're talking about, get so that you're understanding where we're going and what we need from you, and to hear what your relationship is. This is an urban campus. It has unique problems. You are in that urban campus on a regular basis. We need to hear what you say.
Thank you, Cameron. To conclude the session today, we are now going to open it up to the audience for the last 15 minutes. If there are questions, please raise your hand and we will have someone come up to you with a microphone.
Yeah, this is fairly quick. A couple of the candidates are already on board about this, but this is a question about fluoride in water, and I'm sure a lot of you people understand what I'm talking about. Brantford was one of the first cities in Canada to put fluoride in the water, and it had the largest concentration of any city in Canada. And fluoride is actually a poison that's stronger or as strong as arsenic. The amount of fluoride that's in a tube of toothpaste will kill a child. It says on the back of the toothpaste, if you swallow it, get medical assistance immediately. And yet, there's been no movement in the council or through the morality's office to even have a debate about the issue. And this is extremely serious. If you go on the internet, it's just filled with absolute horror stories about how bad this stuff really is. The argument for it is that it prevents tooth decay, but that argument is from the early 40s. But there's been a huge increase in dental care, hygienics, fluoride in the toothpaste and all these things since, which are accounting for the improvement in the tooth decay, not the fluoride. And fluoride's like the devil taking credit for God's work, so to speak. So I think it's time that this gets brought forward, and the city of Brantford, which is basically getting drugged, has an opportunity to say whether they want to keep it or not, because most of the communities around the world are getting rid of it. And Brantford won't even talk about it. That's my point.
Any candidates wish to comment on that?
I'll take it. The issue came up when we were on council before. We got information from both sides, and the benefits of using fluoride in the water far outweigh the benefits of removing it. So I would not support removing fluoride.
Anybody else support fluoride first? There are no good reasons for putting fluoride in our water. It's a neurotoxin. March of this year, the Lancet Neurology, Volume 3, Issue 3, said since 2006, studies have documented additional development, urotoxicants, fluoride. Fluoride's toxic! Now, what's the great reason for putting it in our water? Prevent cavities? Hey, for people concerned about cavities, I, as mayor, will promise to deliver free toothbrushes. Okay? You want to, and besides, 90% of the water doesn't even go in your mouth. It goes straight out to the environment. And you know, if they didn't pass it through you and give it to the water companies for free, they would have to bury it like a hazardous waste. So they managed to pollute the environment with fluoride by passing it through us. And these low-tech clowns sit there and say, there are good reasons. There's no good reason to take poison, especially cavities. Excuse me, that upsets me.
Yeah, we got that.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny because this issue's been going on forever. And I was born and raised here. And I can't tell you that my teeth are particularly good. So all the Brantford water and fluoride in it that I've been drinking all these years, I'm not a good example of it. And I've looked at the documentation from both sides, and I do not see, and I cannot understand the explanations around the concept of ingesting fluoride to improve your teeth. Because the ability for it to actually get to your teeth is almost non-existent once it's ingested. So, other than the fact that you're drinking it and it might be touching your teeth, but then there's not enough fluoride in the water to be able to even act that way, as you would get with toothpaste. So I have the concerns about this, because I don't understand the science or the logic behind it, but I did ask a question, and it was asked in this council, and we had fire and brimstone railed down on top of us because we're not allowed to discuss this issue. And within public health, it is an issue that is sacrosanct. You're not allowed to discuss it. And there was a phenomenal lobby for it. So I don't see the benefits from it. I mean, my own mouth, I don't see the benefits from it. And I don't understand how or where the benefits ultimately be shown. And it's not been shown to me yet. So I think it is a discussion that needs to be had in a very real way, and it is true. Many communities in Ontario and Quebec, in Europe, countries have banned it. So many communities have been moving away from this. Even the last 4 years, communities in Ontario have decided to take fluoride out for no good reason other than the fact that they can't demonstrate that there's a benefit for having it in there.
You can go first.
No, thank you. How many communities in southern Ontario have naturally occurring fluoride in the water based on the well system? Anyone know? Seven. What are we doing? I agree with your question. It's one molecule off Prozac. You're correct. Okay. I understand the concerns behind it, but let's ask the next question. How many people in Brantford actually ingest the water straight out of the tap? I see an awful lot of bottles of water being sold at all kinds of different areas. I don't know what you're doing. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to bring some truth to it. What happens when you go through a Brita? What happens to the fluoride when it goes through a filter? What happens to fluoride when you go through a water softening process? So my question is, how much are we actually affecting with this supposed goal of making sure that we have fluoride in the water to prevent tooth decay? I don't think we've got a system of measurement that makes any sense anymore. If you ask people in different municipalities how they fall on this, it's about a 50-50 both ways. You'll see avid lobbyists to remove it, and you'll see equally avid lobbyist efforts to keep it in. It's worth the question. It's worth to have the debate. I mean, I always had a difficult time figuring out why people would spend about four times the price of gasoline for a bottle of water per volume. That's a different story. But I think it's worth the discussion. I think it's worth asking the people, what do you think you'd like to see happen here? And we're going to echo that with action.
Thank you.
And I don't want to ask. I want to tell.
Candidate Kent.
Yes. I've talked to different health nurses, and depending on how the municipalities and areas are designed, some of them actually have city councilors on the health unit voting, discussing these items. I would love to hear the debate come back to council and have an honest, open discussion on it. One of the areas, I personally don't need fluoride in my water, but I remember growing up where we had it in schools, you'd swish it around your mouth, all different things to help promote that. I remember growing up with that. One of the issues that I do want to look at, if you're looking at fluoride, is the presence of lead. Many of the tenant households in older Toronto, it's been in the Toronto Star or something, one of them, I'm highlighting 13% of the households in Toronto have high amounts of lead still in the servicing. So not only do you have fluoride that you might not want, but you do have lead, which is proven to harm children. So I would like to see some initiatives in Brantford that address some of those tenant households. That's mainly where we hear it, is the tenant households that have been, to encourage them to update and upgrade their plumbing so that it doesn't have lead in it. Thank you.
Could I reply to that? Apparently it's been found that fluoride greatly increases the leaching of lead out of the pipes.
I'm not against removing fluoride from it right now, but I'd like to hear from both sides after.
I'm just going to cut you off there. I'd like to open up once again to the floor if there's a question.
I'm here in Brantford. I'm a professor at Wilfrid Laurier, so I'm really happy to hear all your opinions. My biggest concern moving here is transportation. You touched upon it a little bit in your opening statements, but I'm really concerned about the lack of decent, affordable regional public transportation, as well as the high level of automobile dependence, as well as the lack of car share, and really just the greater need for Brantford to be connected with other municipalities and with Toronto. And so I'd like to hear specifically what your plans are for transportation.
Can I get a field first?
We've consistently gotten low marks in a number of surveys related to use of transit, cycling to work, etc. We've been moving the last little while to put cycling lanes on every road that's being developed as we speak, which is significant. And as a cyclist, I believe it is very important that we move in that direction. This term, this council moved the funds available to put a business plan together for GO. We had to speak to Metrolinx. Our MPP organized that initiative for us to be able to get together. The business plan has been reviewed. We've lobbied successive ministers now. The plan would be for us, and we've done the studies, we recognize that it would function well. We know that there needs to be a subsidy on behalf of the province. They recognize that that's the case because they've done it in other communities. We would see first runs from Brantford, so our transit terminal, to Hamilton, either the end of the line or Aldershot, where you would, and these would be buses in the beginning, very much along the Barrie model, how they went through this to prove and demonstrate the case, and then ultimately you get into the GO train system. And then the second biggest area would be for us to go to Cambridge, which would be next. And I know there's a great deal of issue with Laurier, profs and others who want to be able to travel north south. So that would be the second stage that we would work toward. But it is imperative. If anybody's driven, I commuted for a number of months to Toronto, 2 hours there, 2 hours back. It's getting worse and worse and worse. All we're doing is throwing up a cloud of toxins into the air every time we do this. GO is where we need to be able to go. This council and me as mayor, we moved this forward and it put ourselves in a position where we can realistically see GO happening within the next year.
Thank you. Ken?
Yes, I'm 4 years ago I brought that, and after that 2010 election, Dave Levac told me that he would be following up on the GO Transit that was brought up during that 2010 election. And as you've heard already from me today, one of my very first priorities that I committed to is an integrated transit system so that you can leave your car at home. You don't need to drive it to Aldershot. The GTA doesn't want to see our cars. They're trying to get rid of their cars. They're trying to get us to comply for the air quality of everyone involved. So that's one of the first things you'll see from me is every 30 minutes, around the clock, 7 days a week, so that it's something that you can depend upon. Just as much as nowadays so many of us go to our driveway, we can take our car, I believe that you should be able to take a bus every 30 minutes, around the clock, 7 days a week, So that, and up in Hamilton, or Cambridge, went up there to double check. There's some buses every 11 minutes I can get from the station down in Cambridge all the way to the other side. They've got little timers telling you when the next bus is coming. And it's still the same price that we charge, $3. And the transfer lasts for 90 minutes. Toronto, it's 2 hours the transfer lasts. Here, 30 minutes. You know, so there's a lot of initiatives can be immediately brought in. As soon as you bring up more people, make it more dependable, more reliable, it's already the same price as the others. In Hamilton, it's $2.55 for a trip. More people will take it. I think a lot of people, well, as you could hear in my topic, there's a lot of people that need to take it to make their dollars. We only have a finite amount of money. The more we use it, the more gas tax we will get. We will be working together with other communities if we expand our transit system. We've talked about working with other municipalities. We will, in Brantford, finally be doing our part if we do that. Thanks.
Thank you. Kevin. We'll continue on down the line after this.
Sorry, Kate, I thought that was your order. My apologies. Interesting, isn't it, how we drop off the critical mass of Mohawk students and Mohawk courses in Brantford, and we still have a shuttle that runs between, both my daughters take that shuttle, by the way, runs between Hamilton and Brantford, and has done so for quite some time, and it's cheaper than the model that we're developing right now through GO. And the GO model right now, to go to Toronto, is not the panacea. There will be other routes that are necessary to cover in the future as we reach our critical mass of a new school population. Okay? It's interesting to me to see that the shuttle leaves every time, every morning, on time. We make sure our girls are safe on the bus to Hamilton. We know where we are. We don't have to go there. It's a weight off our mind that they can continue their courses and finish their schooling that they started prior to losing Mohawk. Why is it important to pay attention to the shuttle? Find out how they did it. Find out how they continue to do it. Find out why it is cheaper than any other option right now. It's exciting to me to find examples of what works, what's safe, what's effective, and then duplicate that model. I think we need to do that for Commissioner Waterloo, Guelph, Cambridge. We need to make sure that there is a safe route there as well. I've met a number of students at the door who said that this is an issue, and the Toronto answer will not solve the KW problem. So we will expand our services, but let's take notes from people who have been doing it for a long time with satellite campuses, find out how they do what they do, do it cheaper, do it better, do it safer, so that we can do more of it, more routes, more directions, more places, more students.
Thank you. Candidate Rovell.
Thank you. There's two issues. One, there's the internal transportation that we need to deal with within a municipality. There's always growing concerns about services that are available to us on weekends and other hours that are not necessarily convenient to the current or status quo. And I want to focus on that just yet. I want to come over to the GO Transit site, because here's some interesting numbers. It's 22 minutes from Aldershot to Brantford, and I'm talking about Garden Avenue 403 with an opportunity for what they call a swing station or a turnaround station. It's another 15 minutes to come from Garden Avenue to downtown through those core areas. And that's if you make all the lights with good traffic flow. If we're talking about reducing some carbon footprint or some carcinogenics in the air, let's take this as a trip that goes around. It's an additional 15 minutes in, it's an additional 15 minutes out. Depending on the number of rotations that we have, that's an increase. Why wouldn't we take an opportunity to put a centralized or close proximity station that deals with both municipal transit and regional transit on locations such as Garden Avenue 403, where we have community partners and private sector partners to work through that process. There was a resolution that was proudly defeated by this council that gave an opportunity for the mayor and the board four councillors to meet with the developer and GO Metrolinks to deal with specific option projects along the 28 acres of Garden Avenue, Shellington Place, to create this unique partnership or potential, knowing that we have to do a business plan that is now in place. But the business plans didn't examine, didn't sit down with the private sector to deal with that particular component. So we're missing out on these options, and I think that's part of where we need to go, is not just rely on municipal government, but also to rely on partnerships with business industry to help foster that together. That's dealing with regional. Internally, We've already started with bike paths and creating those by when we do reconstruction of roads, such as Brantwood Park is already done. We made sure that we put bike paths in there. It also deals with traffic congestion and traffic flow to ensure that we don't have people or common measures every building. So there's a lot to know with this particular question. I think it needs to be looked at a lot further. Thank you for your time. Thank you.
Kevin Sandemar.
I commuted from Brantford to Toronto every day for 7 years, except Saturday and Sunday, obviously. And I can tell you it was hell. And the time that it took to come home took twice as long as it took to go to work. And so I can support of introducing GO service and would hopefully like to see the progress accelerated. In terms of Brantford itself, I mean, one of the things that I find a little awkward in my mind when I look at buses, for example, we see these huge buses driving down the road with two or three people on it. And, you know, they come by a regular schedule, but there's always two or three people on it. But we're talking about expanding services and moving into outlying areas. But if we're buying big buses, there's a maximum amount that we're going to be able to support that sort of plan with. So why not look like Montreal did, like Buffalo did, like a lot of these other cities, and move more to the minibus? And they show up, they offer flexibility at time of arrival, and they get you to wherever you need to go at a much more quicker pace. And the cost of maintenance, you save a lot more money on the cost, and it allows you to invest in more minibuses and ultimately end up moving more people around more efficiently.
Thank you. I'm glad to see the discussions that began in 2009 under a committee that I took the leadership role on have continued for the last 4 years. And what I would commit to you is trying to finish those discussions in the first term of council. I'm also committed to north-south corridor running. It's unfortunate that a student that wants to get to Cambridge has to go to Hamilton, to Toronto, and back up again, sometimes taking 6 to 8 hours. Talking about internal issues, Professor, you know, it's funny how William Street, which I happen to live on, which is a lot of student residents in there, where was the city planning and making that pedestrian friendly when they're redeveloping the whole street? It's probably too late now. Where is the bike lane in there? There's a ton of students that live on William Street. So why wouldn't we start in the downtown core in that area by developing it and making it pedestrian friendly?
Thank you. Candidate Jerome.
Well, maybe you would be so lucky enough as to have an opportunity for your daughters to earn bus bucks and pay for that shuttle to Hamilton. Now, there's no shuttle to the north. Yes. Did you know what one of the major attractions of time banks are? Not just babysitting. Rides. People really want rides who don't have wheels. And that seems to be one of the most traded services in a time bank. So yeah, if you can't get organized to provide bus bucks that can pay for a shuttle to Cambridge, let's join a time bank and organize our own shuttle to Cambridge. Now, I'm in favor of 100% subsidized transit so that we can maximize the efficiency and get people out of their cars. Now, most communities pay 80, 90% of their subsidization anyway, so why not go the whole 100? Now, everybody's got a reason to get out of their cars. Oh, but we're going to need more buses. Well, guess what? If we got a crew of kids shoveling the snow, maybe we save some money on the snow budget. And if we have a whole 12 kids going out with each landscaper for the city, helping, he just orders them what to do now instead of doing it himself, maybe we can save money for the city, buy more buses. Gee, 1.5 million extra interest this year. We could save that and buy more buses. So, if we can maximize the use of buses, it's going to solve a lot of environmental problems. It's going to solve everybody's problems because they can now be rushing going by every half an hour, 24 hours a day. I like that too. But we can't afford it right now on a cash budget. But we might be able to afford it if we've got a half of our transactions covered in local money and we're saving half of all that interest or more. So basically, that's it. Subsidize fully, get people off out of their cars.
We will now have 2 minutes for each candidate to have some concluding remarks, starting with candidate Vanderson.
Why would you go the other way?
Oh, if you'd like.
It's okay.
Does anybody really want it?
Oh, you're the moderator. Enforce it.
Okay. Starting with candidate Vanderstel.
Thank you. I often, as a professional artist and as a business person in town, I often forget what I've created. I forget what I've built. I forget what I've done. Because I'm always focusing on the next thing that needs to be done. In Brantford, there are an awful lot of things, according to my observations in the last 10 years, that need to be done. And I would love nothing more than the opportunity to work with whichever group wants to identify the obvious problems that we're faced with in this city and in this county, and work with them to solve those problems and to take the next step. Why? Brantford should be on the cutting edge of problem solving. Brantford should be known for its willingness to work internally and externally. Brantford should set itself apart from all the other communities on so many different fronts that we have not yet done so far. Brantford and the people of Brantford, the people of Bray County, the people of Six Nations deserve that. And where better? We're in Canada. What a great population to work with. The people of Brantford are brilliant. Seriously, simply put, brilliant. When I meet them at the door, you can never predict what you're going to hear. But those are the community changers. Those are the community leaders. Those are the ones you invite into the process of making a much better, healthier, stronger, richer place to live with people who know that they're engaged in the process. People who are invested in the process and not disenfranchised. I think building Brantford better with your help, with your input, and people like you will make the biggest difference that Brantford has ever seen.
Teamwork brings change. Change invites opportunities, and opportunities build success. We have worked diligently put a plan together for this community. The plan includes development and respectful manners of how it's done. The plan includes accountability to you, students, the ratepayers of this community. The plan includes value for your tax dollars, your student dollars. The plan includes an economic component that takes away the red tape and rolls out the red carpet. Integrity, ladies and gentlemen, is respect, courtesy, and trust. Teamwork, another principle of a pillar in this community, it is the ultimate achiever. Without it, success cannot be achieved in the first place. And community, ladies and gentlemen, that is you, and you, and you, and your family, and our neighbors. They deserve much better. Ladies and gentlemen, Brantford deserves much better than what it has in the last 4 years. It has been riddled with letters of B's to wannabes. It has been lettered, ladies and gentlemen, with pushing people back into corners and not allowing them to shine. I believe every individual, every member of council has an opportunity and a skill to shine. I believe you as students have an opportunity to shine as well, ladies and gentlemen. You want leadership that understands what student issues are. You want leadership that understands how to lift people up. And you're talking to a person who's been doing it for 13 years of his life. Taking people who need to be molded to bring them up, to allow them to surpass. I lead, ladies and gentlemen, from the middle. Those who have greater strengths, let them shine. Those who have weaker strengths and fall, turn around because I'm 2 steps behind and pick them up. That's how I lead, ladies and gentlemen. I don't need to be in front of a camera. I don't need to be a poser. If I had a choice between a camera and a lens and a shovel, I'm taking the shovel because that's who I am, ladies and gentlemen. I'm a carpenter first, I'm a family man next, I'm a man of God, and I'm also a servant to this community. Join the rebellion on October 27th. Vote for Dave Rebell.
I taught a course at Laurier University here called Organizational Strategy. At the time, it was a mandatory course for some of the curriculum trends. And but the intent of the course was to teach people how to make enterprises work so they work in the best way possible so that we can all succeed. The core of what we talked about is an enterprise, in order to succeed, has to have a vision, and it has to have a mission. Well, I'd argue that the vision for Brantford is for the city to deliver the best possible services for its citizens to make improve the quality of their lives. The mission is you do that in an affordable and efficient manner in order to successfully implement your program. We've done SWOT studies. The Conference Board of Canada did a report on the city. It ranked number 42. It's dropped to number 48. The measurement is just not about the economic performance of the city. It's about the social, the health, the care for seniors, the environment. All of those things are included in that report. We did not fare well. Over the past year, we lost 1,200 jobs. 1,800 people have gone off the payroll. We have senior citizens walking down our streets who are tripping and falling because they can't move their mobility devices properly. I mean, I think we've got to get back to basics. We've got to take time, resolve the issues that are outstanding in our city, and then move forward with the broader visions. But in the short term, we've got to fix the problems. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Thank you. So first, I'd like to just say my commitments that would affect you, the Laurier students. Consistent support for full beat minute to support downtown student and public safety in the downtown. Commitment to a fair discussion with the students about a fair parking strategy to support students and businesses downtown. Work with the provincial government to address the transit issue and completion of the north-south corridor. Commitment to continuing the growth of the downtown and the development of the Colburn Street south side to attract more commercial, entertainment, and residential housing. And commitment to getting taxes and spending out of control. If you take a minute and visit my website, if it gets back up again, there's been a problem with my server today. I have a 6-point plan, and everybody else has been talking about what the problems are, what they're going to do, but my plan says how we're going to do it. My slogan has turned into stop the flooding. And you know, I know why the mayor wanted to go after me, because he's going to refute the numbers, but the numbers are clear that are right here. $16.8 million in new spending over 4 years. Wasting $4.78 million in a social services upload, and these councillors will agree with me. 39 plus new positions, a whole new department created. $57,000 wasted on a rebranding of the letter B wannabe. $107,000 on the Gretzky signage, and then it goes on and on and on. So I would ask for your support, students that are going to vote, and go to my website, www.latel.ca, and have a look at my plan on how to enforce it.
Candidate Journal.
Well, if you haven't noticed the difference up here tonight, all I've talked about is my one-point plan. Interest-free local currency. And I've explained all the different ways it can be used, whether it's backed up with bus rides or tax credits or babysitting hours or anything at all, dog walking. It's so easy. And here we are all starving with real misery in the streets. You know, and maybe what, 13 students show up here to find out about what's going on and the rest are clappers for their candidates. You know, what a sad experience in democracy that people have so given up hope in us. They don't even come to bother listening to us. And I challenge you. You want to know about political rhetoric? I challenge you when you walk out the door to make a list of the candidates up here and try and remember what they said. Okay? And I bet you can't remember two things one of these other candidates said. Because all it was is things should be better. I want things better for you. This is terrible. Stuff, rhetoric you hear forever that doesn't ever end with a punchline. So try that. Go out there and put their names down and try and remember two things they said. And if you go past one, most people can't even think of one when I interview with them out the door. But me, you heard it every single time. It's an insufficiency of money causing all of our problems. And solving that insufficiency, that gap with local currencies is working in other cities around the country. So, the country, the world, just go do some research. Brantford doesn't have to stay last. It can actually be first at something.
Thank you. Hey, it's remarkable that I don't even know where to begin with some of the misinformation, the falsehoods of the information that's just been spoken about. But I'll happily tell you afterwards. It's mind-boggling. But this council that I've just led has been one of the most effective councils that it's been my pleasure to work with since I was first elected 20 years ago. We've been very effective. We didn't just talk about the problems, point them out. We just didn't keep repeating what was going on over and over and over again. We actually acted on none of these problems. The issues related to jobs. The truth around jobs in the city of Brantford is in the last 4 years, we've grown up more than 4,000 jobs. And that's identifiable. Also, we want to deal with taxes. This is the lowest tax council in the last 15 years. And we can do even better. Safety, we initiated the Safe Brantford Initiative, we've hired a coordinator, we brought together a broad-based community team to be able to make this a reality, and Laurier and the students will be involved in it. Growth, we're going to be dealing with boundary adjustment with the county. We're close, we've already got a letter of intent, now we need to be able to fine-tune both the numbers and what the compensation is going to be. And the last one is health. This is what people are concerned about, this is what they're caring about. It's not our area of government, usually it goes to the province, but we are the one body that understands our community better than anybody else. Access to doctors, education, prevention, we do this better than anybody else, and we've initiated that as well. This was an incredibly effective government under my leadership, and I want to continue for the next 4 years. I'm asking for your support, and I'm asking for your vote on October 27th. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Mary Ellen Kay, and I'm running for mayor. I'm a person who actually uses transit. I can verify that the system of that the city has tried in the past don't work. They don't encourage people to use it. It's not dependable. I'm a person that does not drive their bicycle on the sidewalk because I do trust the other drivers in Brantford. When I'm on my bicycle, like I've always been raised, I follow the rules of the road, and I'm fine. So one of the things is I am a person that looks at how people work, where they go to, where they make their living. Yes, we've had some job growth. It has not been high-paying wages, though. And we have a lot of people in Brantford on a very, very tight budget. I know how tight that is, personally. So one of the things, I'm committed to benefiting this community. It sounds like an expensive start with the transit, but that is the part that brings it all together for communication between students. Oh, you can have a nice dedicated one for Mohawk College. That just helps people at Mohawk College. Current students who are enrolled in Mohawk College. It doesn't help people in Brantford who have specialist appointments all over the place, who have had their license pulled because their health problem has gotten in the way of their transportation. That's what I hear at the door. So if you care about a broad sector of the population, you might consider voting for Mary Ellen Kay. I'm asking for your vote. A lot of good things can be done in Brantford. And yes, Brantford got a D. St. John's, Newfoundland got an A. I have a friend in Newfoundland. Within a short period of time, he found an affordable housing situation. I said he was thinking about coming back to Brantford. I honestly could say they got an A. Find out why they got an A, because he was already a part of Newfoundland, and you say, yeah, I know why they have. They have hospitals. They have doctors. They have a transit system that goes all over the city. They have education. They actually have it subsidized the best of any of the provinces. Vote for Mary Ellen Kay. You'll be glad you did.
Thank you. To conclude today, I would like to thank everyone that showed up. I would also like to thank every single one of our candidates who showed up here today to make comments. And just to conclude, let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you.